Greetings, everyone. I'm Adam Harriton, and this is An American Chestnut Tree. I decided to film a video on American chestnut because I've received a lot of comments and questions and requests to do so, but rather than film your typical American chestnut video, where the entire focus would be the decline of this species due to a fungal disease known as chestnut blight, I thought I would instead address another topic that's overlooked yet still very pertinent, and that topic involves the status of American chestnut in pre-European settlement forests here in North America. How dominant was American chestnut in eastern North America prior to chestnut blight? If you ask most people with at least a passing interest in trees to say something about American chestnut, you will consistently hear the same thing. American chestnut was a dominant tree in eastern forests prior to the introduction of chestnut blight. It's not difficult to see why anyone, including myself, would say such a thing. Websites, magazine articles, books, and field guides routinely make the claim that American chestnut was the most abundant tree in these early forests. To cite a few examples, the American Chestnut Foundation states on their website that the American chestnut, Castanea dentata, once dominated the forests of the eastern half of the United States and southern Ontario, Canada. The SUNY College of Environmental Science and Forestry states on their website that American chestnut was the dominant tree species in the eastern forest. And Scientific American states that before the early 1900s, one in every four hardwood trees in North America's eastern forests was an American chestnut. Now, when we read and hear such statements, we may picture in our minds an unbroken expanse of American chestnut forests extending from Maine down to Florida. But was that ever really the case? Is it possible that American chestnut was not so dominant of a tree in pre-European settlement forests? Before we answer those questions, I want to revisit very briefly the topic of why mature American chestnut trees are less common today. The reason involves, but isn't solely caused by, a fungal disease called chestnut blight. Chestnut blight was introduced unintentionally by humans who imported Asian chestnut seedlings to North America over a century ago. The fungus responsible for chestnut blight enters wounds in the bark of American chestnut trees and kills the cambium. Billions of trees have succumbed to the disease. An American chestnut has been, to a large degree, eliminated from the overstory of many forests. As you can see though, living American chestnut trees do exist today, including this one that is capable of fruiting. Now back to the claim that American chestnut was the dominant tree in eastern forests. I live in the great state of Pennsylvania, which I think most people would agree is part of the eastern forest biome. When we look at the natural distribution of American chestnut, we see that the entire state of Pennsylvania is represented. But was American chestnut the most abundant tree throughout the entire state of Pennsylvania? To get some answers, we can look through the scientific literature, and we could start with this article that analyzed tree composition figures for five different areas in pre-European settlement forests. All five locations in this study were within the natural range of American chestnut. So, how common was American chestnut in these eastern forests? Well, the authors of the study made this surprising discovery. Quercus rubra, northern red oak, Quercus prinus, chestnut oak, Castanea dentata, American chestnut, and Acer rubrum, red maple, were relatively minor components of pre-settlement forests, rarely ranked among the 10 most abundant tree species. Later in the paper, the researchers stated, American chestnut ranked among the top 10 species at only one location. And in their conclusion, the authors stated, the pre-settlement forests were primarily oak forests. White oak was dominant by a large margin. Now, of course, this study only looked at five areas within a relatively small portion of American chestnut's natural range. But another study looked at the composition of pre-European settlement forests in a different area, this time in north-central Pennsylvania, which again is well within the natural range of American chestnut. The results of this study were a bit different, showing that American chestnut was apparently more common in this general region. But in no instance was American chestnut the most abundant tree in any of the plots studied. In 3 out of the 4 areas, white oak was more abundant. And in the area where white oak was less abundant than American chestnut, eastern hemlock and American beech were more abundant than American chestnut. And yet another study, this one focusing on pre-settlement forests in a portion of western New York, showed that American chestnut was outnumbered by American beech, sugar maple, white oak, black oak, and other trees. So what's going on here? Was American chestnut ever a dominant tree in eastern forests prior to the introduction of chestnut blight? Well, the answer is, it depends. It depends on how we define the word dominant, and it depends on what we mean by eastern forests. Dominant in this context implies most abundant, and as we just learned, American chestnut was not the most abundant tree in several pre-European settlement forests. The bigger issue, I think, is what we mean by eastern forests, which, according to the National Park Service, stretches over 26 states from Florida up to New England and southern Canada, and extends as far west as Texas and Minnesota. As you might imagine, an incredible amount of diversity in temperature, precipitation, topography, and geology can be found throughout this entire broad region. The claim that American chestnut was the most dominant tree throughout the entire eastern forest biome, at least where the region overlaps with the natural range of American chestnut, is, to put it bluntly, illogical and unsupported by data. Now, a fantastic article was written on this very topic with the appropriate title, Did American Chestnut Really Dominate the Eastern Forest? The authors, Edward K. Faison and David R. Foster, shared similar information on American chestnut's less dominant role in early eastern forests. In their article, they stated that early land survey data reveal that chestnut was far less abundant at the time of European settlement than the oft-quoted 25% of the forest. Data from about 100 counties or townships across 8 states of the upper Midwest reveal that chestnut was never the dominant tree, comprising 5 to 15% of trees in a small section of Ohio and 0 to 4% of trees in the rest of the region. And when referring to data collected by a well-renowned naturalist by the name of Emma Lucy Braun, Faison and Foster stated that her surveys and data tables reveal that chestnut was a tree of surprisingly limited dominance. So why is it then that today so many people claim that American chestnut was a dominant tree in eastern forests prior to the introduction of chestnut blight? Well, it turns out that while American chestnut was a bit less dominant overall in earlier forests, there were some areas in the United States in which American chestnut really thrived. Going back to the article by Faison and Foster, American chestnut was spectacularly abundant in some locations. On North Slopes in Joyce Kilmer Memorial Forest in North Carolina, for instance, it comprised over 83% of the canopy trees. And on the slopes of Salt Pond Mountain in Western Virginia, it made up 56 to 85% of the canopy trees. Chestnut could also grow to enormous size. In a forest in central Kentucky, chestnuts, which comprised 22% of the canopy trees, were by far the largest trees. Now we're getting somewhere. American chestnut, it turns out, was the dominant tree in some eastern forests after all. The key word being some. And then there's this article where the author, Emily W.B. Russell, stated that American chestnut was abundant on ridges and sandstone soils in Tennessee and was a dominant species of rocky ridges and slope forests of western Maryland. Russell then goes on to say, however, that chestnut was essentially absent in the almost pure stands of hemlock or white oak, as well as in the swamp forests, and that in the more northern woods, American chestnut did not dominate the forests. And when we look at the concluding thoughts written by Faison and Foster in their article, we read this. The tree remained absent from fully 2/3 of the eastern forest, precluding it from ever being the dominant tree of this biome. So American chestnut was a common tree in some pre-European settlement forests. It was capable of reaching impressive sizes, and its value to these ecosystems, to the fauna, and to humans was tremendous. But the claim that American chestnut was dominant throughout all eastern forests in North America is unsubstantiated. its abundance decreased with increasing latitude, suggesting a limitation in range associated with cold temperatures. However, American chestnut was a dominant tree in parts of its central and southern range, particularly in mountainous areas. But because of its preference for growing on moist, acidic, well-drained slopes and on rocky ridges, American chestnut was often outnumbered in eastern forests by trees whose habitat preferences were more general. Such generalist trees included the mighty oaks, notably white oak. So I hope this information begins to paint a very general picture of what the land might have looked like in the not too distant past. Of course, I don't think we'll ever really know exactly how it was back then, because nobody alive today was around back then to tell us exactly how it was. But we can still ask questions and study and learn and read others' accounts and attempt to connect some pieces together so that the feeling of being left out or adrift or without a place to call home is just that, a feeling, but not reality. Reality is that by paying attention to the land and learning what happened to the land, you become a faithful adherent to the land, like American chestnut, which, despite its challenges over the years, is still around. It's still here with us, which means we could observe it, we could study it, we can learn it, we could celebrate it, and we can lend it a hand. Thank you so much for watching this video. I appreciate it. Hope you learned something. Hope you enjoyed it. I encourage you to subscribe to the Learn Your Land YouTube channel to stay current with more videos like this one. I also encourage you to head on over to learnyourland.com and sign up for the email newsletter. And if you are on social media, feel free to give Learn Your Land a follow on Instagram and on Facebook. Thanks again for watching. I'll see you on the next video.